The Woman Who Walked Into the Sea by Mark Douglas Hume. Read by David Monteith. 1. A vase of blue African lilies, Diana's favourite, filled the church alcove. Mary Anderson stopped in appreciation before selecting a prayer book from an oak table at the back of the nave. She glanced about her, expecting to find other early arrivals already seated, but the church was empty. How fitting, she thought. It would allow her a few moments of reflection to remember Diana, and to take her place without having to encounter anyone from Poletown and the unpleasantness that always brought. As she progressed along the aisle, she admired the other displays of flowers, a cascade of reds and burnt orange beside the pulpit, and another arrangement of similarly rich colours to the left of the altar. Late summer blooms were Diana's favourites. If Diana had to pass away, Mrs. Anderson reflected with a tremble at her own encroaching mortality, then wasn't this the best season for the church to be dressed as she would have liked? She consoled herself with this thought before turning her attention to her choice of pew. The third, or even second row would be appropriate, considering how close she had been to Diana and to the family. But each of the front four rows, on both sides of the aisle, were cordoned off by blue silk rope. An attached, reserved notice disconcerted her, causing a gloved hand to lift uncertainly to her mouth. Mrs. Anderson turned to see whether anyone had followed her in, an usher perhaps, someone of whom she could ask guidance, but she was still alone. Inspecting each of the pews in turn, she chose the aisle end of the fourth row on the left. She lifted the rope off its brass hooks and, once seated, felt satisfaction at her decision. From this position, the family would be able to move her forward, as she was sure they would. And if that were to happen when the church was full, everyone would witness her elevation. Mrs. Anderson experienced a brief but enjoyable frisson of pleasure at the prospect of such a public display of favouritism. She settled herself, placed the prayer book with its stiff maroon cover on the wooden ledge by her knees, and bowed her head. After reciting the Lord's Prayer in a whisper, she stared sightlessly at the stained glass window above the altar and remembered Diana. How she was that first weekend at Bray House, already Mr. William Ritchie's fiancée, the romance, if that was the word for it, having taken place the preceding months in Edinburgh. How Diana had sought out Mrs. Anderson in the kitchen on the pretext of helping with lunch, but really to inquire about her husband-to-be. "He'll bully you," Mrs. Anderson had said in her forthright manner, "because you're a pleaser." That much had been obvious after 5 minutes in her company. Diana was one of those women who, having been abandoned by one husband, Mr. William had forewarned Mrs. Anderson of that fact, settled on smiling compliance to prevent another occurrence. "Stand up for yourself, or he'll walk all over you," Mrs. Anderson encouraged her. Not that she'd said so at the time, but hadn't it also been obvious that it wasn't a love match? Oh, Diana liked him well enough, but in Mrs. Anderson's opinion, the partnership had been a trade-off. Financial security for Diana and Alexandra, her 6-year-old daughter, and in return, Mr. William acquired a social secretary, someone presentable who would organise his life in Edinburgh and accompany him to Faculty of Advocates gatherings, while making few, if any, emotional demands. There were worse foundations for a marriage, as Mrs. Anderson used to tell Diana when she rang tearfully from Edinburgh after more of Mr. William's fault-finding with her appearance, her weight, or her incomplete education. She hadn't attended university. Under the circumstances, Mrs. Anderson liked to think of herself as the glue that held the marriage together. She'd done for Mr. William at Bray, his weekend and holiday house northwest of Ullapool, for so many of his bachelor years that she had learned to rub along with him despite his distance and moods. Hadn't she deserved the rewards of making Diana her project? The cottage beside Bray's walled garden Her home now for more than 30 years was the most obvious. But there had been others, presents from Diana, as well as innumerable kindnesses in recognition of Mrs. Anderson's loyalty. There had also been the privilege, as she considered it, of belonging to a family like the Ritchies. Sometimes, she liked to think, Mr. William and she shared a trait. Each recognised weakness and took advantage of it. A rich man like Mr. William could do so by bullying and ill temper, a housekeeper by making herself indispensable. And that was what she had become to Diana. Mrs. Anderson closed her eyes, and her head shook a little, a tremor from the past. How long into the marriage had Diana broken the routine of accompanying Mr. William for every weekend at Bray? 8 or 9 years, Mrs. Anderson thought. By then, Alexandra was 15 and out of control. She was seeing an older boy from Pawltown, and Diana had been determined to discourage the relationship by remaining with her daughter in Edinburgh most weekends. Mr. William would love having Bray more to himself, Mrs. Anderson looking after him, just as it used to be, Diana insisted. The truth, as Mrs. Anderson knew, was that by this time Diana needed separation from her husband's unpleasantness just as much as she desired to prise apart Alexandra and her unsuitable boyfriend. If she had an opinion on Diana's strategy, Mrs. Anderson thought Mr. William would grow to enjoy his weekend solitude and would resent its temporariness, as well as Diana, when the family was reunited in Edinburgh on Sunday nights. As it happened, both were wrong. What hadn't entered either woman's thoughts was Mr. William's susceptibility to a seductress. Mrs. Anderson's neglect of the possibility was mostly practical. That type of woman, being as rarely seen in coastal northwest Scotland as pure-blood wildcats, and conditioned by observation. William Ritchie, QC, had never been romantic or a womaniser. By disposition, he preferred the company of men, ideally other lawyers, and was awkward around women, avoiding even a social kiss on the cheek if possible. Then there was his age, late 50s, surely too old for a midlife crisis, especially for a man who found pleasure in respectability and routine, as well as in disapproving the incontinence and mistakes of others. Mrs. Anderson still referred to the affair and its aftermath as his madness. They were desperate times, with difficult decisions to be made, an agony for them all, the bloody mess that had to be cleared up. What was done, she said to herself, with a wondering shake of her head. Not only Mr. William's madness, hadn't insanity infected everyone to a greater or lesser degree? Afterwards, Diana had been so frightened he would kill himself, she sat at night outside his locked bedroom door. Mrs. Anderson remembered his crying. Such emotion! It made her wonder where he'd kept it all this time. Diana forgave him, of course, blaming herself for leaving him alone, as a pleaser would. For his part, Mr. William appeared as regretful for the distress he had caused as for his moral lapse. From Mrs. Anderson's observations, the shell of the man made a better husband, a better man even, certainly a nicer one. Hadn't he and Diana another 20 years together before his death? Good years, which Mrs. Anderson remembered with affection, with each change of the calendar moving her closer to the centre of the family. Suddenly, she was overcome by a sense of loss. Mr. William gone, now Diana too. She found a handkerchief in her bag and dabbed her eyes. Of course she'd offered to go to Edinburgh to nurse Diana, but Alexandra had turned her down, saying her mother was too proud to let anyone but a stranger do those sorts of tasks for her. And anyway, wasn't Mrs. Anderson too old and decrepit herself now? Mrs. Anderson's reply had been sharp, justifiably so. There had also been the hurt over the cremation, which had been arranged so quickly, and in Edinburgh too. The lack of notice made attendance by Mrs. Anderson impractical.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.